The subject of my speech is Byzantine and Arab nautical technology in the Middle Ages. I will respect the time limit, and I will limit myself to the last part of my speech so as not to tire you. It is a fact that a general conclusion that can be drawn is that the Arab warships and the Byzantine warships in the Middle Ages did not differ much. They were mostly the same. They used the same technology. And this is understandable in all situations of meeting of civilizations and even of war, that one civilization takes and technological advances of the other and uses them. This is what happened with the Byzantines. They took from the Arabs the Greek fire. The Greek fire, this method of throwing fire from ships, was not, as is usually believed, a Byzantine invention. It was actually an Arab invention. We have it in Arabic medieval sources. And the Byzantines took that from the Arabs. Not as is commonly believed in Europe that the Byzantines invented it. This is not correct. And of course the Arabs used other methods and other technological methods of Byzantine. Now, we have an excellent source about all this from the 10th century AD. It is a chronicle of a Greek chronicler who lived in northern Greece. He lived in the city of Thessaloniki. It's the second most important city of the Byzantine Empire after the capital, Constantinople. Now, Thessaloniki is a city by the sea, and it is an important port. And like all cities by the sea, it was walled, not only on the three sides surrounded by land, but it was walled on the sea side as well. It had the famous sea walls. Unfortunately, they do not survive today. In 904 AD, an Arab fleet headed by Leo of Tripoli crossed the Aegean and headed towards Thessaloniki in order to capture the city. It besieged the city for about a month, and it finally managed to capture the city. Now, there was an eyewitness of that siege and of the sack, of the subsequent sack of Thessaloniki, called Ioannis Kamenyardis. He was the Leo of Tripoli when he sacked the city, along with riches. He took many slaves and took them back to where he came from, and Kamenyardis was one of those slaves. Now, he survived his ordeal of slavery and came back and wrote the chronicle about his adventures. I will limit myself to what he tells us about the ships, only because it's an important source of ship technology. First of all, he tells us that the Arab and Byzantine ships did not greatly differ. He informs us that the Arabs captured many Byzantine ships, mostly commercial vessels, merchant vessels, some of which they lifted up from the bottom of the harbor by means of a winch machine. This also proves the fact that knowledge about the ships was shared between the two cultures, because when they had in their hands, the Arabs had in their hands Byzantine ships, they could share and examine them. Now, as I said, he was taken slave by the Arab fleet, and he mentions that the ships had two decks. The top deck was occupied by the Arabs, and the bottom one was occupied by the slaves, which, he says, was very dark and foul-smelling. I believe from this description and from the fact that it is very difficult in the hot Mediterranean climate and conditions to have closed decks, I believe that he refers to an open deck on top. And what is the bottom deck? It must be the hold of the ship. Usually that is where both Byzantines and Arabs put their prisoners in, on the hold of the ship, the bottom part of the ship. And this is corroborated by a 13th century Arab official a Mamluk official who lived in Egypt, Ibn al-Makali, who states that in the lower bank of the ships, the Arabs sometimes used as a hospital. Therefore, from this source, by the way, was discovered and translated in English for the first time, as I know, by Professor Christidis, who is in the audience today. By this source, we see that the Arabs used the bottom part of the ship, or the hold of the ship, for auxiliary purposes such as a hospital or storing the slaves. Now, the second point I would like to say is about the rig of the ship. There is a confusion as to how many rigs the Byzantines and Arab warships had. And it's also known that they were equipped with a superstructure like a fortress, like a wooden castle on top of the ships. This is a wooden construction. In the Greek sources, it is usually translated halfway up the mast, so we must imagine the mast of the ship, and halfway on top of it, a wooden castle. I don't know how practical that would be. It has been suggested that this reading of the Greek sources should be not halfway up the mast, but halfway between the masts, between the two masts. This looks a little more practical, but again, this puzzle was solved by the discovery of this source, the narrative of Ibn al-Makali from the 13th century, who says in an Arabic translation of this Byzantine source, the source is Leo, the Emperor Leo's Navmatica on ship war strategy. And the Ibn al-Makali's translation is that in every ship there is a forecastle by the mast, next to the mast. So this shows that the wooden construction, this sort of castle, was found by the next to the middle mast of the ship. Again, this points to the fact that the ships have more than one mast, probably one further forward and one in the middle. Now, one other thing I would like to point out is that our chronicler, Kaminathis, mentions in particular the use of black Arab soldiers. This has been inferred by the Byzantines to mean not literally black soldiers, but the fact that the Byzantines were so terrified by the Arab warriors that they used this expression to show how fierce the warriors were, and they didn't in fact mean actual bad soldiers. But I believe that Kaminathis must have been an eyewitness account, since he was taken slave, and he must have seen actual black soldiers. We know from many Arab sources that the Sudanese in particular were renowned warriors and very fierce soldiers, and I believe that in the army of Leo Tribulus, there must have been Sudanese warriors. They were very good with the bow as well, the Sudanese. So there is no doubt that Leo's fleet actually numbered black Sudanese soldiers among its ranks, and Kaminathis is a corroboration. And one last thing I would like to point out is that Kaminathis mentions the way the Arabs sacked Thessaloniki, and in particular the sea walls of Thessaloniki. The sea walls were high compared to the ships. And so what the Arabs did, and Kaminathis tells us, is that they joined the ships together and they constructed a kind of makeshift wooden tower on top of the ships in order to reach the fortified walls of Thessaloniki. And this passage, again, provides information about the technology of the ships. First of all, that the mast amidships was the biggest of the two, so that they would have the towers constructed or not. That they had big steering oars. Kaminathis tells us he used their steering oars in order to construct these towers. And also it points out to the tactical plan that the Arabs had in order to capture Thessaloniki. They approached the city not with the stem, the front part of the ship, but with the stern, the part aft behind the ship. So they this points out to the fact that the ships were probably higher aft than they were in the stem. And it is interesting that exactly this passage is corroborated by a later source. The Chronicles of the Crusaders mention a similar tactic by which the Crusaders managed to besiege and managed to sack Constantinople, the capital, in 1204, that is 300 years after Kamianis. Now, the Chronicle, two Chronicles, and Robert de Clary mentioned in the Chronicles that the Crusaders devised that the ships should be bound together, two and two, and should carry scaling ladders. And these ships were ready to attack one tower from the sea walls of Thessaloniki. And also, Robert de Clary says that the Crusaders used bridges swinging from the masts of the ships. In other words, 300 years later, the same tactics were used by Westerners this time, by Crusaders, to capture the city walls of Thessaloniki, which of Constantinople, sorry, which was the capital, and were much more strengthened and higher. Now, we can only imagine the Byzantine ships, because we have no depiction of a Byzantine drum, the warship. We can also imagine how the Arab ships look like, the ship type used called sheathing, the Arabic sources, so which must have been similar to the Byzantine. Unfortunately, we have only made reconstructions. But the city walls, again, unfortunately, about the city walls, we can imagine them because they don't exist anymore. The walls of Thessaloniki have disappeared totally. There's not a remnant of them at all. And the walls of Constantinople, the sea walls, have disappeared apart from one or two towers, very scant. We cannot even imagine the city. I should explain here, as you probably know, that Constantinople was the exact opposite of Thessaloniki. It was surrounded by three sides from the sea, and the fourth side was looked to the land. And therefore it was fortified on the land side, but also it had sea walls on the three sides that surrounded Constantinople by, that the sea, sorry, surrounded Constantinople. Now, can we not imagine the city walls? We're fortunate in that we have one depiction, which is very rare, of the walls of Thessaloniki, and I would like to seek the assistance here. In 1555, that is 100 years, sorry for this, this is the city of Constantinople. I may use this. This is the city of Constantinople. All these are the city walls, the sea walls, excuse me, as they have looked in 1555. Now, all of this has disappeared. This part is the Golden Horn, as it's called, the small gulf in Constantinople. None of this exists. And this is the site that the Crusaders must have seen when they sacked Constantinople. And this is where they used this technique with their ships and carried ladders on top. We are fortunate, as I said, that this Danish painter called Melchior Lorck visited Turkey and painted a few pictures of Constantinople as it must have been seen. Thank you very much.